Church founded by ex-slaves and slaves' masters, the fourth son in February 1868.
The historic what now?
Roanoke Baptist Church.
Oh, Roanoke Baptist.
Named after Roanoke, Virginia. This one of the slave masters was from Virginia, and that's how the church got its name.
And is it real close by? Where is it?
It's at 315 Whittington Avenue, and I can't believe that you're not familiar with
it. Oh, Whittington?
Yes.
Ah, okay, yeah. Yes.
You know about the story of the fire that was supposed to have been mysterious there at 4 o'clock in the morning on the 22nd of December 1963, and it burned from an unknown origin that was a known origin.
1963. Well, what was the real origin?
It was set.
The arson by unknown person?
At 4 o'clock in the morning. The president of NAACP was James Don Rice.
Was what?
James Don Rice, president of NAACP, pastor of Baptist Church for a year. During the civil rights struggle, Churches of NAACP leaders throughout the South were mysteriously burned from unknown origin. It became commonplace. Reverend Rice, the pastor Ronald, he had been there a year before the fire, was called by someone's voice that sound just like yours, not you.
That's where I heard that voice before. Huh? Okay, so.
And the voice said that we have warned you and told you about your NAACP activities and troublemaking work in this community. We have asked you to stop, and you have continued it. Now we want you to look out the door and see what's happening to your church. He took the phone and said, would you repeat that so I can get it very clearly, and hand it to his wife. And they repeated the same thing. And they got up and they went out, and people were gathering around the house to protect him in the community. 63 Malvin Avenue was flourishing. He went to the church and it was in flames. Listen to this part of the story. A fireman from the fire department in front of St. Joseph ran in 4 inches of snow with an axe on his shoulder from the 100 block of Whittington to the 300 block of Whittington where the church was, and found the door had been prized and broken open, and cushions from the seats piled in the floor and soaked in some type of explosive and set fire. And that was the cause of the church. That wasn't published for 40 to 50 years. The reason it wasn't published, because it wasn't going to bring the church back. The pastor was very reasonable. He said what the system, I talk about the system in here, in three stages of it. He said what the system wanted him to say, that we needed to rebuild. And we don't tell that story in writing, because we had to forgive.
Okay. Was that the Sentinel Record at the time?
That was a Sentinel Record here, and that's a perfect question from you. They didn't call until they received a call from UPI in Chicago, where Reverend Rice had a friend, associate that worked, who was publishing the story, because they knew him, as to what happened here. And they called Sentinel Record to ask him if they had the story that he had. And Sentinel Record called Reverend Rice. That's in here also. The fact that Reverend Rice received a call from UPI regarding the story about the fire before Sentinel Record ever called.
Now, 1963 61, did you say?
63. Now, they published the fact that...
So were you back in... Were you here then?
I was on a date. I just got here. Yeah, I had been here 3 months.
Was that your church then?
That was my church. I was the last member to join before the fire. You know, when I came, I joined. Nobody else joined until after the fire for years. But I was here at that time, and the fire was mysterious, and we were 10 years rebuilding. What the Cinema Record published was that all the departments came out. They were there all day long. It was snow on the ground. Church was 95 years old. Arkansas Baptist College was founded there. It was pastored by Reverend James Donald Rice. The fire was mysterious. We don't know how it happened. It was worth $250,000. The amount of insurance on it was $33,000. Church members stood in the snow and greed. These are all facts. But they don't get into the civil rights issues. It wasn't expedient at that time to mention that he was president of the NAACP.
Well, you say it was not reported to have been arson either?
No, that still hadn't been told. He told it, yes he did. He told it, and at the 135th church anniversary, I think that's 40 years later, after the 95 years, I believe he told it 40 years later. And he told me over and over again, that story about the fireman mysterious was to not be told anymore. Don't say it anymore. Nothing was mysterious about it. But listen to me, Rice said it himself. I wonder, did he forget it? He called it mysterious. The system called it mysterious.
You lost me on who's telling you what now.
Rice, the pastor.
The pastor Rice?
Yes,
okay.
He referred to it as a mysterious fire. Okay. And 40 years later, he said it wasn't mysterious. It was expedient to call it mysterious.
Well, there wasn't any interview of any of the...
That wasn't expedient either.
Firemen about what they found, allegedly, with the...
Oh, nothing. Nothing, yes. No interviews. The fire chief was enforced to. He was snowbound. He couldn't get here. And they came back to fire marshal, prosecuting attorney. Nothing. No, none of them. We've had some in 2015. We had several in the United States in 2015, church burnings, mm-hmm. not in Arkansas, but it was commonplace. I don't know how we got in all this. I didn't mention it in here. And my reporter wants to, or publisher wants to go into details on it, and I'm sure, I'm positive, I won't have much help in digging into this and find out anything, because the members didn't want to talk about it.
Are you a participant still in your church in something?
Yes, one of the few that was there at that time. I had to be careful because...
I mean now.
Yes, yes. I'm an officer. I'm chair of the deacon board.
Okay.
I sing in the choir. Yeah.
You do sing in the choir.
Oh, Alex.
What's your favorite?
You mean the part that I sing, bass?
No, what song or hymn is your favorite?
The Negro Spirituals, and I'll have
not a single
one. Every one of them. We don't do any.
You don't do any? They don't sing your favorites. It's not PC.
I don't do a single one of my favorites.
Is that because it's not
maybe
PC?
One. What's PC?
Politically correct. Don't sing Negro spirituals.
It's not popular with the black culture. The black culture is like to me, they say, okay, let's go to the right. We are here talking about single motherhood as opposed to think about single fatherhood and poverty and ignorance and reading and writing or the lack of it. And how everybody gonna go pro?
What?
Professional football.
Oh.
Every kid is gonna make 40 million. You're practicing to the left or to the right. A couple of people in the community that I know, Charles Smith, you may be familiar with him. He looks at me and he knows what's on my mind. Church, you'll be singing. He spent 90 minutes, oh my goodness, in rehearsal, singing songs. And one song we did, I'm involved in it. We said the same thing 56 times, because I'm counting.
You said the same thing 56?
Yes.
You mean the repeating lyrics of the song? Is that what you mean? You mean to say the lyrics over and over again?
This crap. I want to go out the back door.
Yeah.
Ooh, man, it gets so ridiculous. I'm just out of place, but I never leave.
So, what's one example of a song you like?
I don't want to remember.
Can't think of one?
I mean, I do like, go down Moses, way down in Egypt land, till the Now, in King's Church in Atlanta, that's all they do.
Huh.
In the East, Alabama and Georgia.
Not just that one song, but Negro spirituals.
See, there were hundreds of spirituals. I got a book of them. But in college, we did about 15, 18, and 20. Some of them, the slaves created while they were singing. See, they couldn't read or write. They created songs that they were singing, and somebody eventually wrote them, and the slave didn't remember from one month to the next the song that they had sung. Some of them got into print, I think a couple hundreds. But in college we did about 20. At my church, zero. It's zero. Well, now we do Lift Every Voice and Sing every Sunday in February. We got middle class blacks that want to hear once a year, and that's it. I was talking to someone a month ago. There are blacks that don't want to mention NAACP. You didn't know that. They don't identify with it. They won't talk to you about it. You ain't supposed to know all that. They want it to be perfect, but they're not perfect. Obama's not perfect. The Bush wasn't perfect. Clinton wasn't perfect. None of those people were perfect.
And the one perfect one, what they execute him, didn't they?
You gotta hear this story. No. I hope you got not a big rush. One of the characters that I write about in here is Hovey Henderson. Hovey Henderson is the principal at Langston School. Kennedy was assassinated, November 1963. Neil Blakely, a great friend of mine and a teacher, was so touched by the death of the assassination of Kennedy. We had an assembly, and we came out of the assembly after it had been announced that Kennedy had been assassinated. And Blake, being moved by the death of Kennedy, spoke to the principal, who was known for his wisdom and knowledge and skills and his art. So Blake said to Professor Henderson, "Prof, why would anybody want to kill Kennedy?" And Prof said to him, shut. He studied when he talked. So they killed Jesus and went on to his seat. Now, when I mentioned that in the writing, the author explained that. Henderson was simply trying to say that if Jesus could die as a human being, we believe that he rose again in that story. And Kennedy was a human being, and he was going to change the United States of America and the world, he had to go. Not going to live very long. King had to die. Robert Kennedy had to die. Malcolm X had to die. They couldn't get to be old as Elmer Beard. That wasn't going to happen. It's happened throughout history. Men who make a major difference must die early.
And just how old is Elmer Beard?
78. I'm a has-been.
When's your birthday?
April 14, 1937.
Right before the tax deadline, huh?
Yes. I'm a has-been. And so Prof. Henderson said, "Shall they kill Jesus?" and sat down. He didn't have to think about it. They did kill Jesus. So this is related to something else I have to share with you. You probably never met anybody around as much as I do. Anyway, this is rambling, and you have to share this with you. In the black community, when I'm trying to get the African-American leaders, meaning the pastors, to understand that we need to continue to raise funds, join the NAACP, support the NAACP, and the NAACP should have a set number or some members in every church representing itself in the church. When I share this with the ministers and tell them how important this is, many of them will say that we shouldn't have politics in the church. This is also true in the white community for many, many ministers, most of them. Keep the politics out of the pulpit. Keep the politics out of the church. We don't want partisanship. We don't want this kind of thing. Very good. I agree with that. And then we preach about Jesus. If Jesus' death wasn't political, then that wasn't a Jesus. How many times have you heard from the scriptures? They marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall. There's a judge in every judgment hall. They didn't find anything guilty about him, yet he died, and his death wasn't political. I'm not a Bible scholar. I don't pretend to be.
Well, you've seen some pretty good base.
They marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall. When I mention this to ministers, they become quieter than you are now. He died. He was killed. He was hanged, not hung. I'm an English major. And it was political. Have you heard or read the book about killing Jesus? It's by one of the main characters on Fox News.
Bill O'Reilly.
Bill, thank you for the assistance. Yes. I read that one. That was political. Jesus had to die. And we don't want politics in the church. The NAACP, as strong as it is today, is a result of politics throughout the 60s, throughout the 40s and 50s through 1990. And I appreciate you guys interviewing me. Thank you.
The Webb Community Center used to have, did there used to be a pool somewhere close
on
by?
On this end up here. When we were separate and unequal, it served a great purpose. And we had a basketball
pool. Now nobody has a pool.
I haven't thought about that way. Then when integration came, desegregation, pools started being closed to the public, and they are part of hotels and motels now. And you check in now, you can use the pool, and maybe nobody get afraid of you thinking you're going to turn the water a different color.
But the NAACP uses this facility. Is that the primary use now of the Webb Community Center building?
The NAACP? Ooh, no. I just left them upstairs in my office, and somebody thinks it's a storage place. That's not a negative statement, because we don't meet there every month. We meet in here. I don't go up there every week. But our headquarters is here. Webb Community Center serves the community. I believe there's a bingo here. There are activities here. There's lunch served here. There are weddings and marriages. And
there's not a computer workstation anywhere for the people to use?
Part
of what I was saying is you went to see the Hot Springs Daily site, so I would show you.
I'm not familiar with the operation of it, but some of that is limited here.
Right.
And it may not be as current as you would expect, because many businesses or people will bring things to the Webb Community Center or when it's about worn out. So if they can't use it, we can't get much service from it either. But we accept everything. Except one time I found some molded and mildew out front that was a copy of it, and I think we had to dump it.
I was going
to
pull it up on this laptop because there is a Wi-Fi hotspot apparently here, but it needs a password.
I'm not familiar. I'd like to see this at some point, but this is what my daughter's concerned about. Dad, you're not modern enough to even interview because you can't tell them what your code is, or you don't know how to go into the
maybe
email.
You can give us your daughter's email, and we can send her a message.
I'll do that to you.
Okay.
That's
thank you.
Thank you. Okay. All right. This name, in love and memory of their daughter, Emma Elise Webb, was the daughter of John L. Webb and his wife. John L. Webb was a wealthy contractor in this community and did much of the building in this community. His home was on Grove Street and Pleasant, that building right there now. And he was an excellent contractor and was known for his building skills and art and humanitarian in this community. National Baptist Hotel and many buildings in this area is credit to him for construction.
Well, did his daughter die tragically?
I don't know about tragically, but she died young. Webb was young himself, not as old as I am now. Webb was young when he died, and his wife died young. And I don't know of any Webbs in existence in this community, but Johnny Webb came out of Alabama, and he was a self-made man. That can be said of an individual.
All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
The Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down.
Down
in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
So Moses went to land.
Let my people go.
He made old Pharaoh understand.
Let my people go.
Yes, the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down, down in Egypt land. Tell all Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
Thus spoke the Lord, bold Moses said,
let my people go.
If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead.
Let my people go.
'Cause the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.